281, we have heard the joyful sound, Jesus saves, Jesus saves. Let's all stand together as we sing. 281, Jesus saves. On that first together, we have heard the joyful sound, Jesus saves, Jesus saves. Spread the tidings all around, Jesus saves, Jesus saves. Bear the news to every land, glide the sea.
Singing this morning. Good to see each of you in the service today. And aren't you glad Jesus saves?
Amen.
And I'm glad he saved me. And I'm glad that this church has been singing that for 61 years. And wonderful to never changes when you believe the truths of the Bible. They never change. And thankful for those who went before us and stayed true to God's word. And now it's our turn to run with the baton. A little Olympic reference for you there. And run with the baton and finish the race and hand it off to the next generation if the Lord tarries. But thankful for the great truth Jesus saves. If you've never experienced that, I pray that you'll experience that this morning. All right. Good to see each one of you here. Let's open with a word of prayer, shall we? Father, we bow before you in prayer. We thank you for another Lord's Day that you have blessed us with. Thank you, Lord, for 61 years of your blessing upon Bible Baptist Church. Lord, about this time, 1955, a group of people met in a little schoolhouse, believing you called them to plant a church in Grove City, Ohio. Thank you for them. Thank you for their faithfulness. Most of them are with you now. And enjoying the fruit of their labor. And Lord, I pray you'll help us to be faithful to what our time to run the race is. And Lord, we want to ask you this morning that Christ will be exalted. We pray that he'll be pleased with our service together here today. Lord, may you use the service in each of our hearts and lives and draw us closer to the Savior because we're here today. If any in this room has never come to know Christ as their Savior, I pray they'll come to know him today. Lord, guide and direct in this service now, and we do ask it for Jesus' sake. Amen. Amen. All right, you may be seated.
In the harvest field now ripened, there's a work for all to do. Hark, the voice of God is calling to the harvest, calling you. Little is much when God is in it. Labor not for wealth or fame. There's a crown and you can win it if you'll go in Jesus' name. Does the Christ you're called to labor seem so small and little known? It is great if God is in it, and he'll not forget his own. Little is much when God is in it. Labor not for wealth or fame. There's a crown and you can win it if you'll go in Jesus' name.
Are you laid aside from service, body worn from toil and care? You can still be in the battle, in the sacred place of prayer.
Little is much when God is in it. Labor not for wealth or fame. There's a crown and you can win it if you'll go in Jesus' name.
When the conflict here is ended and our race on earth is done, he will say, if we are faithful,
welcome home, my child, well done. Little is much when God is in it. Labor not for wealth or fame. There's a crown and you can win it if you'll go in Jesus' name. Little is much when God is in it. Labor not for wealth or fame. There's a crown and you can win it if you'll go in Jesus' name.
Amen. Let's go over to 283, if you would. 283, I have found his grace. It's all complete, he supplieth every need. 283, joy unspeakable and full of glory. Let's sing that first together.
I have found his grace is all complete. He supplieth every need. While I sit and learn at Jesus' feet, I am free as free indeed. It is joy unspeakable and full of glory.
Announcements for us. Listen carefully, if you will. Dinner after church today. How's that sound? And I don't know what about sitting in church makes you hungry, but it does. And so we have a great meal planned in the fellowship hall. All of you are welcome to stay. We hope you will. There's always plenty of food. And there's so many things that Baptists don't do. One thing we do is eat. Okay. Maybe to our fault, but we do eat well, amen? And we've got a good spread out there today. Everyone's welcome to be our guest, especially if you just came in and didn't know anything about it. Stay and enjoy the fellowship. Got plenty out there, and good desserts, and good stuff to eat. So that'll be right after the service today. And then tonight we have a special treat. We have a missionary with us, missionary evangelist Dean Kirshner. Brother Kirshner gives a testimony of Vanya, who is a Russian soldier, a Christian Russian soldier, and his testimony for Christ. And it's a dramatization. He plays the part and sounds the part. He's a friend of Bob Reed, but come anyway. And Bob's known him 25 years, and since 92, met him in Russia, I believe. Is that right? And so just it'll be a powerful thing tonight. Don't miss the service at 6:30 this evening, all right? You won't want to miss that. Then also want to remind you that the Grove City School of the Bible, there's still time for you to sign up if you want to. The sign-up sheet is down on the table. And if you're concerned about the finances, if you take all three classes, I think it's $60. If you're concerned about that or you have a problem with that, you see Brother Moreland or Brother Yoder, and they'll help you with that, all right, and help you figure out how to make that happen, okay? Don't let a little thing like money keep you from learning more of the Bible. Okay, good. Three of us think that's a good idea, but the rest of you will catch on, all right? Don't let that happen. And you see them, and they'll get you set on that. Praying for the family of Marion Skinner. That's Susan Callahan's mom. Marion went to heaven on Friday morning, and or Saturday morning. Friday morning. And the service for Marion will be this coming Saturday here at the church at 10 a.m. All right, this Saturday, 10 a.m. memorial service for her. Pray for Susan and other family members as they're traveling in. Of course, Susan coming from Japan. And so please pray for safety for them as they ride on in. Okay. Oh, I did mention we are having 5:30 Christian growth class. We're continuing our second half of our lesson on Baptist distinctives. Why? We're a Baptist church, and what the purpose of that is. I don't think you ought to be Baptist by convenience. I think you ought to be Baptist by conviction, and we'll teach you that in the class. So you want to be a part of that, 5:30 in the conference room tonight, right before the evening service. All right? I think that's all I have right now. Let's take a moment and recognize any guests we have with us today. We're always pleased when people visit in the service, and met a couple right here. These are the Townsends. They're from New Albany, and great to have them, radio listeners, and great to have them with us today. The usher is going to be coming here momentarily with a visitor's card for you. Brent Gibney, good to see you this morning, Brent. And who do you have with you? Jennifer, good. Jennifer, thank you for coming. Good to have you this morning. That's great. And glad you're here over on that side. And then Brother Forney is here, a missionary with Two Points North and All Points Baptist Mission. Just saw him about a week ago at a great training week they have there for their missionaries and several of the missionaries we support. And it's good to have Brother Forney in our service today. Thank him for driving over and being here this morning. All right. Is there anyone else today? Okay. All right. If you'll take just a moment and fill out the welcome card, we appreciate you doing that. And then a little bit, we have the offering. We'll put that card in the plate if you would, and keep the pen as our gift to you for coming today. We're glad you're here. All right. Let's give them a warm welcome, shall we?
Straying in sin's dark valley, no hope within could I see. They searched through heaven and found a Savior to save a poor lost soul like me.
Oh,
463 together in our hymnal, when the roll is called up yonder, I'll be there. When the trumpet of the Lord shall sound and time shall be no more. When the roll is called up yonder, on that first together. Oh, and the trumpet of the Lord shall sound and time shall be no more. And the morning breaks eternal bright and fair. Oh, and the saved of earth shall gather on the other shore. And the roll is called up yonder, I'll be there. When his chosen ones shall gather to their home beyond the skies, and the roll is called up yonder, I'll be there. When the roll is called up yonder, when the roll is called up yonder, when the roll is called up yonder. Sing the last verse, children. Why don't you go on up to junior church? You're dismissed to junior church, children. On that last together, let us labor for the master from the dawn till setting sun. On that last, let us labor for the master from the dawn till setting sun. Let us talk of all his wondrous love and care. Then when all of life is over and our work on earth is done, and the roll is called up yonder, I'll be there. When the roll is called up yonder, 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 I'll be there. Amen. Great singing this morning. Let's go to 492, if you would. 492, Jesus Christ is made to me all I need, all I need. Would you stand with me as we sing? Jesus Christ is made to me all I need, all I need. He alone is all my plea. He is all I need. Wisdom, righteousness, and power, holiness is very another. Make somebody feel welcome, especially our guest. We'll come back and sing those last stanzas together. Jesus is my all in all. Let's sing that forth together. Jesus is my all in all. All I need, all I need. While he keeps, I cannot fall. He is all I need. Wisdom, righteousness, and power. Holiness is very hour. My redemption, full and free. He is all I need. Glory, glory to the Lamb. All I need, all I need. Let's sing that last together. Glory, glory to the Lamb, all I need, all I need. By his Spirit sealed I am, he is all I need. Wisdom, righteousness, and power, holiness is very
We have a couple half sheets of paper made up. They have a picture of the missionaries that are coming, their names, and even the children and such, and where they are in their deputation or how many years they've been on the field. These are just for you to pray over them and pray for them. And I'm praying that you call their name out in prayer from now till September 15th when the conference starts, and you should be able to greet them by name when they come in. And let them know you've been praying for them and welcome them. And so if you'd like that, they're on the table where the missionary cards are. If you take a card, you have to check that with the ladies that are there. You don't have to check that with the ladies that are there. You can just pick one up, okay? If we run out, we'll get more. But I thought that's a great way to pray for the missionaries coming up and put a face with your prayers, all right? We're glad to have one of our missionaries with us, Brother Gary Forney. Brother Forney, I'd like you to come to the platform if you would, and I want you to pray for our offering this morning. And if you would, just take a minute and update us on what's happening with All Points Baptist and what's been going on with your ministry here lately, okay? All right.
Go ahead and pray first. Okay. Well, good morning. Well, it's good to see you. It's good to be here, and I wanted to come and be with you today. We learned about the anniversary Sunday today, and just congratulations. I think this is wonderful. Amen. Well, I guess very quickly, I'm supposed to tell you something about what we do and so forth. I'm the executive director of All Points Baptist Mission, so let me tell you what that means. I'm like the old hound dog that wouldn't hunt anymore. You know what a hound dog is, it won't hunt anymore, right? He's worthless. But the owner couldn't shoot him, so he just kept him around and fed him till he died of natural causes. And my wife said, "You need to quit saying that." And I said, "Why?" And she said, "Well, people will think you just lay around and eat, waiting to die." So I said, "Well, how about this? I'll tell them I'm the brains of the outfit." And she said, "Well, whatever you tell them is going to have to be believable, you know." But great to be here. And Pastor mentioned that he was up last week. Week before, wasn't it? Tuesday, they were up, and we had a great school this year. I think we fed about 150 people there all week long, and that was with the not only the missionaries, but the chaplains, and the some of the teachers that happened to be there coming and going came from a lot of different places, some of them a long way. And we do this because we feel like that there are some things that missionaries may not have gotten in school. Some of them were mission majors, some of them were not. Some of them came to us from Bible institutes and maybe got very little about missions. And so we try to supplement what they already have with some things that we think will make a difference on the mission field. And so we're glad to be representatives, I guess, of Grace Bible Baptist Church here because of the the support that you've been sending for many years now. It is deeply appreciated. And we couldn't do what we do without churches like Bible Baptist and the mission program that you have here. Thank you from the bottoms of our heart. Barbara would send her greetings. She's a little under the weather with a bad sinus infection. So if you just want to remember her in your prayers, we'd appreciate that. Well, let's bow our heads for prayer, and we'll ask a blessing on the offering. Father in heaven, we thank you today for your love and your goodness to us. Thank you for the Lord Jesus. And Father, as we just sang a little bit ago, we're so glad that you are all we need. And Father, in spite of what may happen, what may come our way, you're still all we need. And we're grateful for that. Bless the offering today, Father. Bless those that give. And we pray, Father, that you would see that each penny of this is spent properly and that none of it is wasted. It would all be that which would further the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ and help to make people ready for the day in which they must face you. We ask all this in Jesus' name. Amen.
I want you to take your Bibles this morning, if you would, please, for our scripture reading to Hebrews chapter 11. Hebrews chapter 11, please, for our scripture reading today. We're going to read verses 24 through 34. Verses 24 through 34 of Hebrews chapter 11. And we read them responsively, as we normally do. We'll begin together on 24, then I'll read 25. We'll alternate reading like that until we end together on verse 34 of Hebrews chapter 11. And as our custom is, let's stand together, please, to read the scripture. All of us standing to read God's word. And we'll begin together on verse 24. Ready? By faith, Moses, when he was come to years, refused to be called the son of Pharaoh's daughter, choosing rather to suffer affliction with the people of God than to enjoy the pleasures of sin for a season, esteeming the reproach of Christ greater riches than the treasures in Egypt, for he had respect unto the recompense of the reward. By faith he forsook Egypt, not fearing the wrath of the king, for he endured as seeing him who is invisible. Through faith he kept the Passover and the sprinkling of blood, lest he that destroyed the firstborn should touch them. By faith they passed through the Red Sea as by dry land, which the Egyptians, essaying to do, were drowned. By faith the walls of Jericho fell down after they were compassed about 7 days. By faith the harlot Rahab perished not with them that believed not, when she had received the spies with peace. And what shall I more say? For the time would fail me to tell of Gideon, and of Barak, and of Samson, and of Jephthah, of David also, and Samuel, and of the prophets, who through faith subdued kingdoms, wrought righteousness, obtained promises, stopped the mouths of lions, quench the violence of fire, escape the edge of the sword, out of weakness were made strong, waxed valiant in fight, returned to flight the armies of the aliens. And let's pray. Father, add your blessing, please, to the reading of the scripture here this morning. Father, we thank you so much for the Bible. Thank you, Lord, for preserving your word, that we hold copies of it in our hand this morning. And I pray, Lord, that you'll bless the special this morning, that it will continue to prepare our hearts, that our heart would be good soil that the word of God will fall into and bring forth fruit in our lives. So, Father, have your way now and prepare us to receive your word in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen.
Oh, I really wasn't one for going to church, you see. But I went that night somehow, in spite of that. They ushered me in with a warm and friendly smile, and five rows back I sat. Story of Jesus I heard them tell. They taught about heaven and one of hell. I listened from five rows back. The words of the preacher man were arrows of burning truth. They reached my heart as he spoke so earnestly. He told how Jesus suffered, how he bled and he died, and he did it for sinners like me. Soon the choir was singing, just as I am. I knew was lost, my life was a sham. I came and was washed in the blood of the Lamb. From five rows back that night I came. What a change, things are different now. Peace and happiness fill my heart. Jesus walks and talks with me, it's passing day. And I know that through the years of time and through eternity, I'll not forget that night my sins were washed away. Oh, the choir was singing, just as I am. I knew I was lost, my life was a sham. I came and I was washed in the blood of the Lamb. From five rows back that night I came. Yes, from five rows back that night I came.
Oh, that's good. Father, we bow before you in prayer now. We thank you, Lord, for a wonderful, wonderful salvation you provided for us through Jesus Christ, our Lord. And Father, we bow before you now as we come to the preaching of your word. Thank you, Lord, for the good music today. It's sure been a blessing to us. I pray it's been a blessing to you as well. And Lord, we ask for your help now as we open up your word. I pray, Lord, that each of us would give our full attention to the only book you've ever written. And that, Lord, each of us would ask you right now to help us to focus and to guard against our minds wandering, being distracted. Lord, help us to hear what you would say to each of our hearts this morning. Please help me as I bring this message today and help each individual as they listen. May your will be accomplished in each and every heart and life. And I'll thank you in advance what I believe you'll do this morning. And I pray it in Jesus' name. Amen. I grew up in near Canton, Ohio. My elementary years were spent in Hartville, Ohio. Anybody know where Hartville is? Brother Yoder does, I know. And a couple of you other folks would. And then lived in North Canton, which is just a small town there. But we were close to Canton and close to where what is called the Pro Football Hall of Fame in Canton, Ohio. And in that Hall of Fame, of course, you go to where men, each year, men get inducted every August. They usually come up with a list in January of men who are eligible to go into the Hall of Fame because of their accomplishments on the football field. And then a group of people from the Pro Football Hall of Fame will vote on those men to see if they get inducted into the Hall of Fame. And usually there's five every year that get inducted into the Hall of Fame. Then when you go into the Hall of Fame, you can walk through the halls and they have the bust of these men and then their accomplishments that they did on the football field in their playing days. And, of course, Canton is the Pro Football Hall of Fame. There's a Pro Basketball Hall of Fame in Springfield, Missouri. There's a Pro Baseball Hall of Fame in Cooperstown, New York. And same process, the same idea. If, in fact, the church that I grew up in Canton, Ohio, the Canton Baptist Temple, Dr. Harold Henniger got the idea from the Pro Football Hall of Fame to have a Christian Hall of Fame. And some of you have been through the church there, and they have portraits of great Christians and men and women of God who did great things for God with their life, and their portrait hangs in the hall, and then a brief biographical sketch of what they did for God. And it's the Christian Hall of Fame. If God had a Hall of Fame, it would be Hebrews chapter 11. This would be the Hall of Faith, if you will, that God would have, where the difference is these names here are not placed here by men, they're placed here by God. They didn't get voted on by anybody. God put these here. And God wanted to hold them up to you and me as heroes of the Christian faith. It's in Hebrews 11 that we read about Abel and Enoch and Noah and Abraham and Sarah and Isaac and Jacob and Joseph and Joshua, all of whom we would expect to see here. And we would be kind of disappointed if we did not see some of them there. Great men and women of faith. It's something we expect. In fact, when I was thinking about this, I thought about what John Newton said. John Newton's the one who wrote Amazing Grace. And he said, there'll be three great wonders when I get to heaven. He said, number one, there'll be the wonder of seeing people there who I did not expect to see there. He said, the second great wonder of heaven will be not seeing some people there that I fully expected to see there. But the third and greatest wonder of all about heaven will be that I am there. And that's probably true. So I expect to see Abel and Enoch and Noah and Abraham and Isaac and Jacob and those names. I understand that. And then there's some other, if you look down in chapter 11, there's some verses here that we don't mention by name the person, but we kind of can tell who they're talking about. For instance, in verse 33, when it says, they stopped the mouths of lions. Well, who would that be talking about? Daniel. It could be referring to Daniel there. When it says that they quenched the violence of fire, that could be the three Hebrew children in the fiery furnace, where the Lord delivered them out of the fiery furnace. In weakness, there was the weak out of weakness were made strong. I think about Hezekiah, who in his weak state was ready to die, and he prayed, and God gave him 15 more years. And out of his weakness, he was made strong. Women received their loved ones back again. Women received their loved ones, received their dead, raised to life again. Two different women in the Old Testament had that happen to them. One with Elijah, one with Elisha. And that took place. Talks about people who were tortured. And, of course, Jeremiah was tortured and whipped. And Zechariah was stoned to death. Talked about some getting sawn in asunder. And they were stoned. They were sawn asunder in verse 37. They say Isaiah died that way. They put Isaiah in the hollow of a tree trunk and sawed him in two. That's how Isaiah met his death. So I expect, by the way, those are great men and women of God. And I expect to see them there. I would be disappointed if I read Hebrews 11 and Abraham wasn't there. Or Noah wasn't there. Or Isaac or Jacob or even Moses that we read about. I would be disappointed that they're not there. But as you're reading that, you get down to verse 30 and it says, by faith, the walls of Jericho fell down after they were compassed about 7 days. Well, that's Joshua. I expect to see Joshua there. But the next person I don't expect to see there. Because it says, by faith, the harlot Rahab. Who? Certainly that's a misprint. Certainly, we finally found a mistake in the Bible. Certainly, she doesn't belong in the Hall of Faith. How did she get in there? After all, she's Rahab the... Yeah. That's all we think about. Did you know that for most of her life, she wasn't a harlot? For most of her life, that's not her lifestyle. She did that in her youth and in her young days, and it's remembered for all of her life. By the way, that's a good warning to young people. Be careful what you do in your youth that could carry with you your whole life. Jewish history actually puts Rahab as marrying Joshua. And they hold her in very high esteem. And she's only one of four women in the ancestry of Jesus Christ. So truth is, most of Rahab's life, she was a faithful follower of Jesus Christ. She's a faithful follower of God. You see, we see the harlot and we forget her faith. We see the harlot and we forget that she obeyed the men of God. We see the harlot and we forget that she got most of her family saved. We see the harlot and we forget most of her life was spent following and obeying God. But she's not alone. The Bible says here, what more shall I say? Time would fail me to tell of Gideon, of Barak, and of Samson. Of Samson. Wait a minute, Samson's a hero? Wait a minute, didn't he compromise? Huh? Didn't he get the haircut in the devil's barbershop? I mean, didn't he mess around with Delilah and he shouldn't have anything to do with her anyway, or his parents didn't want him to? I mean, Samson? Didn't he get in the wrong crowd? Yes, he did. But was he forgiven by God? Yes, he was. Howbeit, did the hair of his head begin to grow again? Yes, it did. And though he had his eyes poked out, and though they made fun of him, they brought him in to make fun one last time. Remember, he asked that lad to put his arms on the pillars of the big stadium there, and he asked God for strength one more time. And he pushed those pillars aside, and he brought the house down in his last performance and killed more Philistines in his death than he ever did in his life. You see, we remember the broken vows, but God remembers his faith. We remember the wrong crowd he got in, but God remembers his prayer. We remember his mistakes. God remembers his faith. But it's interesting, he says, David also, verse 32. David also. Now, we talked a little bit about David in Sunday school. The only man in the Bible that says he was a man after God's own heart. But most of the time, when people think about David, you think about David and Bathsheba. Or David and Uriah. Or David and, hey, his children didn't even live for God. Absalom rebelled against him, and we read about that in Sunday school. Tried to take the kingdom from him. All sorts of problems with his children. But when you read about David in the New Testament, God never mentions Uriah, or God never mentions Bathsheba. He doesn't bring it up at all. It's funny how it doesn't stay on God's mind, but it stays on ours. Isn't that interesting? There sure are some unlikely heroes in Hebrews chapter 11. There sure are some folks who, if we were penning a book about great Christians of the Bible, we might be tempted to leave them out. But God didn't. Unlikely because of their sins and their failures, their mistakes. In there is a fellow named Barak or Barak, B-A-R-A-K. And by the way, if we just did a survey this morning and said, just here, everybody get a 3x5 card, write down your favorite Bible character. I would almost guarantee you I wouldn't have a card with Barak on it. In fact, even now, some of you are saying, who's that guy? Huh? Deborah was a judge. And they were fighting Syria, Sisera and his army. And she chose Barak to lead the army against the battle against... He had an army of about 10,000 men. Now, the army of Sisera, the Syrians, the Canaanites together, they had a huge army. In fact, the Bible says they had 800 chariots of iron. That's like a tank in our day. I mean, Israel had nothing to compare against that. It didn't look real good. And it's not a job that anybody would have volunteered for, to lead an army against the Syrian army. But you understand, God always fights for Israel. And listen, God always will fight for Israel. Don't make no mistake about it. God told David, and he told other kings, don't you ever number your army. Why? Because your strength, your protection is not in how big your army is. Your protection is from me. And as we look at the map of that Middle East and we see tiny little Israel there, surrounded by all the big nations, and they cannot move that little country. And there is no explanation for that except God. God takes care of her. And what God did that day, He had a rain to come, and it rained and it rained and it rained, and the ground got muddier and muddier and muddier. And what do you think happened to those iron chariots? They just stuck right down in the ground. Couldn't go anywhere. And Israel wrought a great victory that day. And Sisera, being the great man of war that he is, ran. He ran away, trying to hide. And he ducks into a tent of a lady named Jael. J-A-E-L. And being the good woman she was, said, you're tired, you're weary, you can rest here. In fact, here's some warm buttermilk. I don't know about you, that ain't going to put me to sleep, but some people like that. And he was one of them. He drank that, and boy, soon he was fast asleep in her tent. She didn't wait for the soldiers to come. She didn't send anybody out for help. She's going to take care of this all by herself. And while he slept, she got a tent peg and the hammer, and she laid that tent peg on his temple, and she drove it right through his head. Aren't you glad you came to church today? She wrought the victory. But wait a minute. It's not Jael that's mentioned here. It's Barak. Why is Barak or Barak mentioned here? How come it's his name? Because he did exactly what God told him to do. He obeyed what God wanted him to do despite what it looked like. He did not go by sight. He went by faith. And you see, each of them, listen, you always show your faith by your obedience. You always show your faith by your obedience. Faith is active, it's not passive. Faith obeys. Every person you read in Hebrews 11, by faith they did something. They did something. When you find out that the tithe belongs to God, You give 10% of what God gives to you back to Him, that's faith. Because you won't be able to put on paper and say how you can do better with 90% than you can with 100. So it's by faith. And you obey by faith. When it's live holy and live a separated life unto God, you do that by faith. You don't do that by sight. When it says be faithful to God and you be faithful to the house of God, you do that by faith. You obey. When it's read your Bible faithfully, praying to God faithfully, you obey. That's why James said, faith without works is what? It's dead. You don't have a faith if you don't have anything to show with it. You don't have any works to back that faith up. Without faith, it's impossible to please God. You have to obey by faith. Don't ever catch yourself, and sometimes we catch ourselves saying, well, I just don't see. Well, I don't see why I have to do this. Or I don't see why God wants me to do this. Or I don't see why. Well, that's the whole thing. God's not asking you to see it. He's asking you to obey it. That's faith. That's faith. And so we see that, listen, people are listed here in Hebrews 11, not because of their perfections. They were far from perfect. They're listed there because of their faith. And I got good news for you. Listen, if they can get in on their faith and not on their perfections, then there's hope for you and me. I'm glad God didn't just put perfect people in the Bible. I'm glad that God included the warts and all. That's Abraham Lincoln when he had somebody doing a portrait of him, and they painted the portrait, and when they were showing it to him, they showed him without the wart that he had on his face. And he goes, no, he said, don't do that. He said, I want the picture of me, warts and all. Well, when God puts the picture of people in the Bible, it's warts and all. But I'm glad because we all have some warts. We all have some imperfections. I want to give you two thoughts this morning, and then we'll go have some lunch. Listen carefully. Number one is this. We are all human beings. Boy, a profound statement, isn't it? But therefore, we all will make mistakes. We all come short. And the come short there is we're all coming short of perfection. He remembers, God. The Bible says God remembers that we are dust. He remembers our frailties. And if God remembers that about us, could we remember that about each other? See, we think it's pretty simple to think we're human and we make mistakes. That's okay until we hear words like this. Well, I can't believe he said that to me. Well, she said that to me and she shouldn't have said that to me. And my question would be, were you expecting perfection? Well, she did such and such to me. Well, wait. Were you expecting perfection? Can I help you this morning? We're all going to forget stuff. We're all going to be critical. We're all going to be unkind. We all will at times be rude. We will, at some point, sin. Anybody go all week without sinning? Maybe Brother Forney could because his wife's not here. Didn't make it through a perfect week, did you? You know why? Because you're not perfect. All have sinned and come short of the glory of God. So if none of us are perfect, we're all human and we're all prone to make mistakes, listen, then none of us should be too hard on the rest of us. We all have a tendency to hold others to a higher standard than we hold ourselves. You know, it's a great revelation when you come to this, when you come to realize, look at other people and say, you know what? They're going to do some things that I don't like. And guess what? I'm going to do some things that they don't like. You better realize that and accept that and understand that. You understand, the only Sunday school teachers we have at Bible Baptist Church are human beings. The only choir members we have are human beings. The only choir director we have is a human being. The only nursery workers we have are human beings. The only pastor you have is a human being. Yeah, I'd get a big amen there, amen. No, you don't. That's all right. But you know what's great? It's God still uses us. Say, why does God use us? Can I help you with something? We're all He has. I know, pretty discouraging. If I was God, I'd be discouraged. But Bob Jones Sr. used to say, when a fellow was discouraged about God using him because of his imperfection in his life, Bob Jones Sr. said, God will use crooked sticks. In fact, that's all God has to use is crooked sticks. Because there's nobody perfect. There's nobody without sin. God will use crooked sticks, and guess what? God will use you. I wish I could get people to understand how God will use you. We read the Bible and we read about these people and we think, man, that's great. Man, God did that for them and God was great for them. But we think in our mind, God never does anything great for me. And God won't do anything like that with my life. Oh, yes, He will. Yes, He would. These folks, I know it says Elijah was a man subject to like passions like we are, but the truth is, all of them were. All of them were just like you and me. They were no different. They're all human. Number two, let me give you the second thought. God always looks at the whole picture. No mention here in Hebrews 11 of Rahab and her life prior to following Christ. It doesn't say David the adulterer or Samson the compromiser or Moses the hothead. God looks at our lives, and can you know, He doesn't remember the sins that have been forgiven. Your sins and your iniquities will I remember no more. New pastor came to a church, and he wasn't there very long, and he heard about a woman in the church that supposedly talked out loud to Jesus, and Jesus talked to her. That was what everybody said. And finally, he talked to her one day, and he was going to try to cure her of this curious habit. He said, "Understand, you talk to Jesus." She said, "Yes, sir, I do. I take long walks, and me and Jesus have a long talk." He said, "Well, listen, next time you have a long walk with Jesus and you have a long talk with Him, I want you to ask Him, what's the last sin that I confess to Him?" She said, "Okay, I'll ask Him." And so a week went by, and he really couldn't wait till next Sunday, and he got a hold of her, and he said, "Okay, did you have your walk with Jesus this week?" She said, "I sure did." "Did you have a long talk with Him?" She said, "I sure did." "Did you ask Him what the last sin was that I confessed to Him?" She said, "I sure did. And I was going to talk to Him a long time about that." He said, "Okay. Well, when you ask Him what the last sin was that I confessed to Him, what did He say?" He said, "I don't remember." That's true. I don't remember it. Because once you confess your sin, He's faithful and just to forgive you of your sin and to cleanse you from all unrighteousness. And He says, I your sin, your iniquity, will I remember? God doesn't forget. He chooses not to remember. There's a difference between choosing not to remember something and just something slipping your mind. So when we say, sometimes we say God forgives and God forgets, that's kind of a misnomer. God forgives and He chooses not to remember. It's an act of His will. And by the way, when we forgive others as God has forgiven us, then we need to forgive, forgiving and choosing not to remember the sin anymore. I told it against him. Because God looks at the whole picture. It means God doesn't allow one thing to ruin the whole picture. Aren't you glad? He doesn't let one trip into sin, one sad event in your life, to be the ruin of you. Don't you let it be the ruin of you either. God's looking at the whole picture. It was interesting in one of the races. I do not remember what race it was. I think the guy was from England, and I can't remember his name. He won a bit. He's a distance runner. And he won another one last night. But this was a shorter than last night's race. But it was a race where he was running, and he actually fell. He got tangled up with somebody, and he fell. But he got right back up, and he kept running. And ended up winning that race. Won the gold medal, even though he fell. He could have fell down and said, forget this. This is done. All anybody remembers is I fell down. No. Now nobody remembers that he fell down. Because he finished the race and had a gold medal around his neck. Don't let one bad mistake or one sin in your life that you have confessed to God and asked Him to forgive you, don't let that ruin your life. If God doesn't hold it against you anymore, if God doesn't remember it anymore, why should you? Look at the big picture. Look at the big picture. God does. You may fall seven times, but the Bible says a just man falleth seven times and rises up again. Get up. When you look at the whole life of David, God says he was a hero of the faith. When you look at the whole life of Samson, God says he was a hero of the faith. When you look at the whole life of Rahab, God says she was a hero of the faith. It was after David's sin he became a man after God's own heart. It was after Samson's broken vows that his prayer was heard. He killed more Philistines in his death than he did in his life. It was after Rahab's harlotry that she was a faithful mother and a godly woman. It was after Peter's denial that he even knew Christ that Pentecost came and 3,000 were saved and baptized. It does not matter, listen to me, it does not matter where you've been or what you have done. What's important is, where are you now and what direction do you want to go? That's all that matters. According to Hebrews 11, you can still be a hero for God. You can still be a hero for God. There's some unlikely heroes in Hebrews 11. You see, you can still walk by faith. You can still obey God. Nobody can undo a past, but listen, you can start today and make a different future. And you sure can make a different ending. You can still obey God and do what God's telling you to do. Now, we said all of these have done it by faith. And that's how you got to come to God. You have to come to God by faith. Faith has to have an object. Sometimes I run into people and I say, if you die, you go to heaven? And they say, oh, yeah, I'm going to heaven. I say, okay, well, what are you depending on to get you to heaven? Oh, my faith. I got faith. I believe. Well, what do you believe in? Am I believing in the piece of wood to get me to heaven? Am I believing in my good works to get me to heaven? Faith and belief has to have an object. Well, the object, the only one to have faith to give you eternal life is Jesus Christ. The angels announced at His birth to the shepherds, and they said, unto you is born this day in the city of David a Savior, which is Christ the Lord. God sent a Savior. So somebody needed to be saved. And that's us. And the Bible says that God so loved the world, He gave His only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in Him, believe in Jesus as your Savior, He'll give you the gift of eternal life. Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man comes to the Father but by me. You just simply by faith acknowledge that you're a sinner, that you deserve to pay for your sin in hell, be punished in hell for your sin. But that's why Jesus came. He came and died on the cross as a payment for our sin, for your sin and for mine, so that we wouldn't have to pay for the sin. Hey, it's been paid for. And He was buried, and He rose again the third day, and God accepted His payment on your behalf and my behalf. And you, by faith, accept Him and His payment for your sin. And God says, you shall be saved. Not might be, or hope to be, or maybe, but you shall be. It's a guarantee from God if you put your faith in Jesus Christ. If you're a Christian here today, would you do what Paul said? He said, I forget those things that are behind, and I reach forth to those things that are before. I press toward the mark. You know, God didn't equip us with eyes in the back of our head. He never intended us to live life looking backward. He intended us to live life looking forward. Keep going forward for God. Some unlikely heroes in Hebrews 11. And there's some unlikely heroes in this room. But you need to realize if God's forgiven you and He's cleansed you and He doesn't remember anymore, you don't need to either. Obey God. Do what God wants you to do with your life. God will use you once again. Be a hero for God. Let's pray, shall we? Father, take the truth this morning. Thank You for the attention of each one today. Father, thank You for including these people in Hebrews 11. It's kind of amazing. We might have been a bit discouraged had it just been Abel and Noah and Abraham and some of those, what we look at and say, those are giants of the faith. But You included the Rahabs and the Samsons. You included David, included Barak. We could have talked about Jephthah. Others that were listed here that are just unlikely heroes of the faith. And Lord, we know we're not very much. But it's the quartet sang this morning, little is much when God is in it. We realize, Lord, that You'll take crooked sticks and use them for Your honor and glory. Lord, we realize when You'll use us, You'll get all the glory. You'll get all the credit, because no one would look at it and say, oh, those folks can do something. And I pray You'd use us. I pray You'd minister to people's hearts this morning. If any in this room have never come to Christ and they've never trusted Christ as their Savior, I pray today would be the day of their salvation. If any in this room today, Lord, several somebodies have realized all I think about is my failure. All I think about is my sin, that I really messed up. I pray, Lord, that they'd realize if they've confessed that to You and forsaken it, You've cleansed them and You will not remember it anymore. And You desire to use them as a testimony and as a trophy of Your grace. Help them to be a hero for God. Heads are bowed, our eyes are closed. I'll finish this prayer in just a moment. But right now, with your heads bowed, just between you and God, I wonder how many people in the room this morning would say, Pastor, you talked about coming to Christ by faith, asking Him to be your Savior, receiving His gift of eternal life. There's a time in my life when I've made that decision. I from my heart trusted Jesus Christ as my Savior. I know I'm saved this morning. I know I have eternal life. Here's my hand as a testimony. Would you slip it up for a moment that I may see it? Pastor, I know that I'm saved. Okay, you may put it down. You're here today and would say, Pastor, I'm not sure about that. I didn't know anybody could be sure that when they die, they'd go to heaven. Would you let me pray for you this morning? If you're concerned about that, just slip your hand up and put it back down and say, Pastor, pray for me today. Not going to embarrass you, not going to call you out. You couldn't raise your hand the first time, but you'd raise it this time. Just slip it up and say, Pastor, pray for me. Would you do that? Just slip it up and back down. I'll see it. Is there someone like that today? Let me pray for you. Okay. Thank you. Thank you. Anyone else? I wonder how many believers here this morning. It's a preacher, God spoke to my heart about these unlikely heroes of Hebrews 11. And Pastor, if God will use them, I pray God will still use me. Oh, I'm certainly far from perfect. In fact, I've got some mistakes and some things I regret in my life. But God's forgiven me. He chooses not to remember anymore. And I'm asking God today to help me put that behind me. And that I'll press toward the things that are before. I'll press toward the mark. And I'll live the rest of my life pleasing God and obeying Him. Pastor, God spoke to my heart today. Would you slip your hand up, Christian, and say, pray for me this morning? Amen. Amen. Wonderful. God bless you. You may put them down. In a moment, I'll pray and we'll have our invitation. Christian, if God has spoken to your heart, you respond to Him. The altar will be open for you to come and pray. If you want someone to pray with you, there are people who will do that. Just want to spend time alone with God. You do that. If you're here today and you've never received Christ as your Savior, when others are coming to pray, you just slip from your seat. I'll be right down here at the front. You meet me. We have people who've been trained. They'll take a Bible and they'll show you how you can know you're on your way to heaven. If you're here today and you're saved and you've ever been scripturally baptized, you ought to come and say, Pastor, I want to be baptized today. You're saved and you're baptized and you believe this is the kind of church you ought to belong to. Then you ought to come and say, Preacher, we want to belong to Bible Baptist Church. We want to serve God here. Whatever it is that God's dealt with your heart about this morning, I want you to respond to Him. Father, thank you for speaking to our hearts today. Lord, I pray that your will be done in every heart and life. I pray, Lord, that no one would resist you this morning. Whether it's those who ought to come to settle the matter of salvation, those who ought to come for baptism, those who might come for membership, Christian, just coming back and bowing the knee and saying, God, use me. Use me. If you can use crooked sticks, use me. I'll yield to you and I'll obey you by faith. Use my life to influence others for Christ. Father, have your way, please, in every heart and life. I'll thank you for it. With your heads bowed, you stand to your feet. As you stand to your feet, our pianist plays. As she plays, Bob's going to sing the invitation hymn. The Lord has spoken to your heart. Respond to Him this morning, will you? That's right.
Thy strength in need is small. Child of weakness, watch and pray. Find in me thine all in all. Jesus paid it all. All to Him I owe. Sin had left a crimson stain. He washed it white as snow. Lord, now indeed I find thy power and thine alone can change the leper's spots and melt the heart of stone. Jesus paid it all to Him I owe. Sin had left a crimson stain. He washed it white as snow. For nothing good have I, whereby thy grace to claim, I'll wash my garments white in the blood of Calvary's Lamb. Jesus paid it all, all to him I owe. Sin had left a crimson stain, he washed it white as snow. And when before the throne I stand in him complete, Jesus died my soul to save, my lips shall still repeat. Jesus paid it all, all to him I owe. Sin had left a crimson stain, he washed it white as snow. I hear the Savior say, thy strength indeed is small. Child of weakness, watch and pray. Find in me thine all in all. Jesus paid it all, all to him I owe. Sin had left a crimson stain, he washed it white as snow.
All right, go ahead and be seated for a minute if you would, please. Appreciate your attention this morning. And we're glad to have Cedric Carwell coming this morning. And Cedric is a result of our RU Inside program at London. We met him out there, and he was faithful every week. He's a graduate, actually, of the course there at London. And now he's here starting, he's actually from Tennessee, and he's starting a new life right here in Columbus. And God's already provided for him, and he's working a couple different jobs, and God's doing good things in his life. But he received Christ at the program there, and he wants to follow the Lord in baptism this morning. So we're excited about that, Cedric. God bless you. And we're so pleased with what God's doing in your life and the direction you're headed, brother. It's the right direction, and we're rejoicing with you. If you take follow Brother Bob right down the steps there, he'll get you all set and ready to baptize this morning. And Brother Peter, someone, you can get the children to come on up, Children's Church, let them know they can come in. Oh, they're coming in right now. Good. They can come in and see the baptism. All right, Brother Bob.
Well, I sing a few favorites this morning, something that maybe we haven't sung in a while, or we don't pick your favorite song for our congregational sometimes. But anybody have a favorite? Brother Linderman? Number 45. It's one of the most dangerous and petrifying things for a song leader is to do a favorite. All right, 45, I love it. It's still the blood. Let's sing that first together. Once I wandered in sin's black night, and there was no way I could make my wrongs right. Then that old accuser to the Lord did cry. He is a sinner, and now he must die. And it's still the blood that saves from sin. It's still the blood that cleanses within, from the highest star in heaven to the depths of the sea. It's still the blood of Jesus that brings victory to me. Let's sing that second. Then I heard a voice saying, Father, I'll go, I'll pay. In Calvary's flow, I'll bear in my body the marks of the cross.
save that child who is sin sick and lost. Sing it now. And it's still the blood that says within, from the highest star in heaven to the depths of the sea, it's still the blood of Jesus that brings victory to me. Gotta sing that last now. There are those who rely on the works that they do, and some men count on the times they pray through. But when the battle's over and my last song is sung, I'll go home through the blood of my Father's precious Son. And it's still the blood that saves from sin, and it's still the blood that cleanses within, from the highest star in heaven to the depths of the sea. It's still the blood of Jesus that brings victory to me. Amen. That's great. Ann Moreland. 184. 184. Day by day and with each passing moment, strength I find to meet my trials here. Let's sing that first together.
Day by day and with each passing moment, strength to find to meet my trials here. Trusting in my Father's wise bestowment, I've no cause for worry or for fear. He whose heart is kind beyond gives unto each day what he deems best. Lovingly is part of pain and pleasure, mingling toil with peace and rest.
How many, that's the first time you've heard that song? Yeah, okay. It's a beautiful, beautiful song. So here, wow, that was good.
This is Cedric Harwell. Cedric, upon a public profession of your faith in Christ as your Savior, and in obedience to his command, I baptize you, my brother, in the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit, bearing the likeness of Jesus' death, and raised in the likeness of Jesus' life. And the servant said, Master, it is done as thou hast commanded, and yet there is room.
Amen.
Yes, ma'am. 89. Mansion over the hilltop. I'm satisfied with just a cottage below.
I'm satisfied with just a cottage below. A little silver and a little gold. But in that city where the ransom will shine, I want a gold one, that silver.
Isaac. Number 8. Number 8. Are you sure?
I told you this is the song leader's worst nightmare.
For what earthly reason would the Heavenly Father send down his Son to suffer rejection and pay for crimes he had not done? For what earthly reason would the Father let him on the tree? I wept with the answer that one earthly reason was me. I was that reason, that one earthly reason. I was a guilty, he was a sacrifice. I was a taker, he was a giver, dying while I'm free. That one earthly reason was me.
It's a really pretty song. I just don't know it real well. Is that Pastor? All right.
Don't sing one more song when it's time to eat, amen? Are they ready? Think they're ready? Okay. All right. Let's stand together, shall we? Parents, make sure you go with your children through the line. Okay, remember, there cometh those after you. Okay, don't make the, 88th and 89th guy in line have not much to choose from, okay? So remember, it's not a smorgasbord. It's not a buffet, okay? Just take something and leave something for somebody behind. Then when it's all done and everybody's through, you want to come up and devour, go ahead. Okay, that's kind of how it works. All right, let's pray. Father, thank you for this morning. Thank you, Lord, for meeting with us and just been a delight to be in the house of God today. Father, thank you for each one that's come to be a part of the service. Thank you for Cedric and his obedience to you in baptism today. God, keep your hand upon his life and use him in a great way to serve you. Father, we ask your blessing on the meal now. Thank you for the many hands that have prepared it and prepared the fellowship hall for it. I pray, Lord, you'll guide also in our conversation over the meal that the things we say would be pleasing in your sight. Give us a good afternoon. Prepare our hearts what you have for us tonight in the evening service. It's in Christ's name that we pray. Amen. I'm so glad I'm a part of the family of God. Let's sing it together, shall we, Bob?
I'm so glad I'm a part of the family of God. I've been washed in the fountain, cleansed by his blood, joined hands with Jesus as we travel this sod. For I'm a part of the family of God. Amen. You are dismissed. We'll see you.